Hello and welcome to today's webinar on the Pickle Challenge. I'm Joe Tai from Values Coach, and today we're going to cover what I think is one of the most important challenges facing us in America and in the world today, and one of the biggest problems, frankly, that's facing us, and that is dealing with toxic emotional negativity that prevents people from being happy and successful and achieving their dreams, and that serves as an invisible anchor holding back the performance potential of organizations. I often show this picture. If you've heard me speak or attended one of my previous webinars, you may well have seen this. I found it on the internet. And look at that picture. It's a tabby cat looking in the mirror, and there is a lion looking back. And the question is, who could you be if you could look in the mirror and see not just who's there now and not pretend to see less, but who could you be if you were really living your values? Who could you be if you didn't let fear and negative thinking hold you back from doing the things you have to do to achieve your goals? Who could you be if you had a more positive, more cheerful, more optimistic attitude? And I found this picture. Actually, I have a poster of this hanging in my workout room at home. It's a statue called Self-Made Man by Colorado artist named Bobby Carlyle. And in her statue, there's a man with a hammer and a chisel, and he's carving himself out of a big piece of stone. And that is such a brilliant metaphor for what life is all about. Because in life, we're given hammers and chisels. We're given tools in school, at work, in church, at home. We're given these tools and taught how to use them. And if we use them, the challenge is to carve away those parts of our personality, of our character, that we're not proud of. And very high on that list is whining and complaining and other forms of toxic emotional negativity, so that we can build up those parts of us that make for a great life, those parts of us that we are proud of. I'm sure you've seen this quote by Charles Swindoll, and he said, "The longer I live, the more I realize that attitude really is everything, that I am convinced that it's only 10% of what happens to me, and 90% of my life is how I react to what happens to me, and how you react is defined and determined by your attitude." And here's something I've thought a lot about. I have, as many of you know, I have not ADD, but RBADD, really bad. That is not the biggest problem in America today, even though it said we have an epidemic of ADD. The bigger epidemic, the bigger problem is EDD. We have an epidemic of enthusiasm deficit disorder. Almost any problem you face, almost any problem in this country, can be successfully dealt with if we have a sufficient level of enthusiasm. In our course on the 12 Core Action Values, which is the core curriculum of our Values Collaborative, I hope your organization is or will participate, Core Action Value number 10 is enthusiasm. And I am increasingly convinced that is the master value. If you're enthusiastic, it makes everything easier. Life is good. And if you're not, life just sort of drags and you don't get much done. Elizabeth in our office found this on the internet. "When you spend your time today complaining about yesterday, it's not going to make tomorrow any better. And as I thought about it, I thought it's even worse than that. The more you complain about what's going on today, the more absolutely certain it is you're going to have lots more to complain about tomorrow. Why? Because your view of today is the best predictor of what happens tomorrow." Martin Seligman is one of the leaders in thinking about positive cognitive psychology, and he wrote the book Learned Optimism. And he said, "The very best predictor of your future is what you expect it will be." And I guarantee if you're spending a lot of time whining and complaining about all the bad things in the world today and all how the world's not bending over backwards to make your life more easy and more convenient, you're going to have the same thing going on in your future. And one of the challenges is to change your attitude. One of the best books on the subject is A Complaint-Free World by Will Bowen. I hope you've seen it. I'm going to recommend something that he talks about later. But here's his definition of why we complain. It's to have people sympathize for us, to feel sorry for us, to get attention, and to avoid taking the risks to do the things that we know we need to do because we are afraid. So instead of doing it, we simply make excuses, and very often all complaining is, it's making excuses. So we're going to cover three things in today's webinar as I try to help the rhinoceros in you become the unicorn in you. Number one, I am hoping to and expecting to help you see toxic emotional negativity for what it really is and for the effect that it has on you and the people around you. Second, as I always do on webinars, almost always, I'm going to share 12 very practical actions, 12 tools that you can take to be a more positive and more productive person in your own life. And number three, I'm going to challenge you to challenge the people where you work to do the same thing by taking to heart the Pickle Challenge and to transform your organization to be more positive and more productive. This is a challenge that I'm giving you, and I hope through you giving your organization a challenge to get the pickle out of your mouth and to stop encouraging other people to whine and complain to share their pickles by commiserating with them. Now, I call people chronic complainers pickle suckers because that's what they look like. They look like they were born with a dill pickle stuck in their mouth, and they're always whining and complaining. And think about what a pickle is. It is a fresh vegetable, a cucumber, that's been soaked in vinegar. And you know, the most toxic, the most negative people, that's sort of what it feels like to be around them, doesn't it? It feels like they've been soaking themselves in vinegar. I wrote an article in our Sparkplug newsletter a month or so ago, and I said, complaining is the mother of all bad habits. And when you think about it, think of any bad habit that you have, you're probably complaining about it, and chances are the reason that that habit has become so bad is because you were complaining about something. And if you can just stop complaining, it will have a ripple effect back through a lot of the other bad habits that you have. Complaining, toxic emotional negativity, I think of it as cigarette smoke for the soul. It makes you sick the way smoking would make you sick. It makes the people around you sick the way that if you light a cigarette, it just pollutes the lungs of everybody around you. That's what happens when people start complaining. It affects everybody around them. Daniel Goleman, who is the pioneer in popularizing concepts on emotional intelligence, wrote the book Social Intelligence, and he said, when somebody dumps their toxic emotional negativity on us, whining, complaining, temper tantrum, anger attack, they, at a physiological level, they cause the same mental circuitry to occur in us. So if one person is whining and complaining, it physically has the impact of dragging everybody else down that's within earshot. Now, you know, it's amazing how young people today, you tell them people used to smoke on airplanes, they don't believe it. But are you old enough to remember when people smoked everywhere? They smoked in hospital beds. They smoked in restaurants. Parents smoked in cars with kids and in meetings. People smoked everywhere. 1986, when Dr. C. Everett Koop, one of the great American heroes, he said, we're going to have a smoke-free society. Everybody wondered what he was smoking because back then it seemed like an impossible goal. But, of course, today we're pretty much there. I was in North Carolina a week ago. I went to a restaurant that had a bar. It's smoke-free. North Carolina, the heart of the tobacco industry. And what would happen today if somebody lit a cigarette on an airplane? They would meet the air marshal. And it's a great metaphor because today you hear people complaining everywhere. All you have to do is sit in an airport for 5 or 10 minutes, and sooner or later you're going to hear somebody complaining about something. And in its own way, that environmental, that ambient complaining is the emotional equivalent, the spiritual equivalent of cigarette smoke in the air. And one of the single most powerful things you can do to make your life better, to make your family life better, to make your work experience better in your organization is collectively to get the pickles out of your mouth. And I promise you this, if I could come to your organization, your whole community, your family, wave a magic wand, and for 30 days there would be no bitching, moaning, whining, complaining, and gossiping, the other BMW club. There would be no finger-pointing, rumor-mongering, passive-aggressive, undermining behavior. If we could do that for 30 days, you'd never go back. The way we'll never go back to allowing people to smoke on airplanes or in hospital cafeterias. Why? Because we have become so appreciative of how nice our life can be when we're not chronically being poisoned by other people's cigarettes. we would get used to the fact that we don't have to put up with people dragging us down emotionally with their own misery. And anytime you catch yourself complaining about something, anything at all, pay attention. You'll see that I'm telling you the truth here. You're saying three things, and they're all the same. Poor me, poor me, poor me. I'm a victim. Poor me, number one. You're complaining because something is bothering you. Otherwise, you wouldn't be wasting your time and your mental energy complaining about it. You'd be thinking of something more positive and constructive. Poor me, number two. Well, it's not your fault. Otherwise, you wouldn't be complaining. You would be looking in the mirror. And anytime you complain about something, if you really pay attention, you're pointing a finger at somebody else for causing you whatever unhappiness or inconvenience it is that you're complaining about. And poor me, number three, there's nothing you can do about it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be whining and moaning. You would be working to fix the problem instead of just playing the role of the passive, learned, helpless victim. I can't think of a better definition of victim than something's bothering me, it's not my fault, and there's nothing I can do about it. And at a toxic and insidious level, the more you complain, the more you're convincing yourself that you are a helpless victim, unable to deal with the challenges that life throws your way. And it undermines your strength of character. It undermines your ability to get things done. It makes you a weaker person. I was on an airplane recently, and we had the pilot come on, and he said, ladies and gentlemen, I got good news and bad news. The good news is that thanks to a nice tailwind, we're here 20 minutes early. The bad news is, because we're 20 minutes early, there's another plane at our gate, and it's going to take another 10 minutes. So the net impact is that we still have 10 minutes ahead of schedule. What do you think I heard all around me? 360-degree complaining. The guy sitting next to me says, oh, great, we get punished for being early. How do you, and you know, if you spend enough time on airplanes, you're going to see things like that. Another time I'm on an airplane, this guy comes on, he's gone on the Gold's Gym tank top and muscles bulging out at every corner, and he looks like this really powerful, strong guy, and he sits down, he cranks open his cell phone, and out comes this stream of poor me, crybaby, wah, wah. Starbucks was not, they didn't have my kind of caramel latte and my flight, and I had to run all the way. You know, he had this outer body that was, in a way, masking his inner weakness, his inner inferiority. He had a strong body, but he obviously had a weak mind. And that raises two questions. Question number one, are you a victim or are you a visionary? Victims wallow around in the past. Anytime you're complaining, you're mentally in the past. Whether it's 2 minutes ago or 2 years ago, you're whining about something that has already happened by definition. Visionaries don't have time to do that. They're too busy looking forward with their dreams. You can wallow around in the past complaining. You can look into the future with dreams, but you can't do both at the same time. Second question, are you grateful or are you resentful? You can be grateful for the blessings of your life, or you can be resentful. And any time you complain, what you're saying is, whatever blessings I have in my life, it's not enough. You know, I get to fly from New York to San Diego, but my flight was delayed by half an hour, so it wasn't enough. I got to stop at Applebee's, but they didn't feed me on the plane, so it wasn't enough. And any time you catch yourself complaining, you're not able to be grateful for the blessings of your life because you're whining about what you don't have. I think of complaining as the unprayer, the anti-prayer. My friend Michael Crosby wrote this book, Thank God Ahead of Time, and that was the philosophy of Brother Solanus Casey. Whatever happens to you, say thank you, and it will change your life. I read this book, Six Word Memoirs. It's Smith Magazine asked people to write their life story in six words. And my favorite one, somebody wrote, cursed with cancer, blessed with friends. And you think, My, that's got to be somebody with an old soul, a lot of life experience, but it's not. It's a 10-year-old kid. And if a 10-year-old kid can deal with cancer by finding the blessings in the friends that they make, what can happen to you or me that instead of whining and complaining about it, we can't deal with it effectively with strength and courage? Complaining is always a projection of your own inner negativity, your own negative self-talk, your own misery. People who feel good about themselves, people who feel good about life, they don't complain about stuff. It is always a projection of what's going on the inside. And I know some of you are not agreeing with me right now, but pay attention. Really carefully pay attention. Anytime you get negative self-talk, if you analyze it, you'll find that in one form or another, what it is a complaint. You're not good enough. The world isn't treating you fairly. Something like that. And often that becomes projected outward in the words you use and the tone of voice you use as a victim, as a crybaby, as a whiner, as a complainer. And in a previous webinar, I talked about negative self-talk and how do you deal with negative self-talk, and I'm not going to go into that too much, but I talked about the split personality of, you know, we all have this inner child we're supposed to take care of. We also have an inner spoiled brat, and I used the character Gollum from the Lord of the Rings to define it because he was really the epitome of it. You have on the one hand the whiner, and the whiner, you know, is, if only we won the lottery, everything would be okay. And that gets expressed outwardly as something like this. I was on a 3-hour flight, and all they gave me was a stupid bag of peanuts. And then you have the screamer. You don't deserve to win the lottery. And that gets expressed outwardly in statements like this. I can't believe it. Screw it again. The company, blah, blah, blah. I don't get paid enough for this, blah, blah, blah. And it's the victim. It's the screamer, the whiner, all being projected outward in the words you use. And when you complain, you have an impact on the people around you. And so here's a question. Analyze yourself. Are you an energy faucet? When you walk into a room, do you project a positive, cheerful, optimistic attitude that brings people up? Or are you an energy drain who walks into the room and through your negative attitude, your complaining, your whining, your pessimistic, this'll never work attitude, do you suck the life out of it? Energy drains are emotional vampires. They suck the energy right out of the people around them. They suck the energy out of their organization. They are the black holes that suck the life out of people all around them. So you ought to wear a pin like this. I'm allergic to negative people because they suck the energy out of me. Complaining is contagious. You just watch. If you're at a restaurant or at an airport, or when one person starts complaining about whatever it is, the food is cold, the pretty soon all the people around them are complaining. That's why the word commiserate, if you break it down, commiserate, it means be miserable together, like the toothbrush and the toilet paper here, always trying to one-up each other. And it's malignant. One person starts and everybody else has to one-up that person. And unfortunately, when you try to create a more positive environment in your family, in your organization, in your community, in your own life, you're swimming against a very strong negative emotional current in this country and I think many other parts of the world, because there's this stream, this flood of toxic emotional negativity. And nobody has caught it more eloquently and brilliantly than this guy. He's a comedian named Louis C.K., and he was on a late-night talk show, and the video went viral. And you have a hard time finding because the TV show keeps yanking him off. And that's the most recent site where I've been able to find this 3 or 4 minute video called Everything is Amazing and Nobody's Happy. And it's hysterically funny, but the reason it's hysterically funny is because we can see ourselves and the people around us in it. The reason it is so funny is he has nailed dead on one of the problems in this country. And it is that thing is starting to take on a life of its own. You can actually go online and you can buy an Everything is Amazing and Nobody is Happy t-shirt. Spark plug observers in our studies, when the people who go through our values course we call spark plugs, and we often engage them in a study of their own organization. without getting into the technique of how we do the study, we simply ask them to try to extrapolate what percent of paid hours in your organization get wasted on moaning, whining, complaining, gossiping. And the results are about 10 to 15% across the board. And this is very consistent with what Gallup and Press Ganey and HR Solutions and everybody who studies employee engagement comes up with pretty much the same findings, that about 15% of people are aggressively disengaged in their work. And I don't think that's a coincidence. In one hospital that we worked with 3,000 employees, our spark plug group did a very extensive observational study where they just tracked how much of this they were hearing. And we extrapolated from that and found that more than 10 million times a year, somebody would complain, gossip, or engage in some other form of toxic emotional negativity, 10 million times per year. Now, if you think that's outrageous and not possible, that's about 1.1 times per hour per employee. And that's horrible, but I'll bet in your organization, if you really pay attention, or in your own life, about once every hour, every employee has something to complain about, or they're talking about somebody else, or they're not taking responsibility. They're in some way engaging in toxic emotional negativity. And what is the impact in that hospital? What's the impact? And by the way, this is a hospital that does pretty well. They have pretty good patient satisfaction. They have very good quality indicators. But how much better could they be? What's the impact anytime a patient hears an employee complaining about something? What's the impact on morale and productivity when people get into these circling the drain, vicious circle, complaining contests to see who's got it the worst? 10 million times a year. I think of it as 10 million points of darkness that suck the life out of the organization at that individual point. And do the math. 10 million times a year you get something like this, the result will be poor morale, reduced productivity, a marketing image that is substantially impaired, customer or in a hospital patient satisfaction is reduced. And you run the risk of hitting what Jim Collins in his book How the Mighty Fall called stage four decline, which is where people don't know the values, they aren't bought into the mission, it's just a job, just a paycheck, and they can't wait to get out at the end of the day. One more thing that reaffirms how serious this problem is. Most of the people on this webinar know that I publish an email newsletter called Spark Plug. It comes out twice a week, typically. And I recently did a study, and I just asked two questions. And we had more than 850 people, readers, respond to it. Now, keep in mind, people, by definition, people who subscribe to a publication like Spark Plug are pretty positive people. And so I asked two questions. One, what percent of employees in your organization are really engaged in the work they are? Spark plugs. Almost half of the people said fewer than one quarter of my coworkers are engaged, are spark plugs. That means 3 out of 4 people, it's just a job, just a paycheck. And the second question, what percent of total paid hours where you work get wasted on toxic emotional negativity, things like complaining and gossiping? Almost half said more than 20% of all paid hours get wasted on toxic emotional negativity. Now, at a fundamental level, there's a problem of integrity here, because that means that 20% of all the paychecks that go out are the company or the hospital or the organization is paying you to do work, and you're taking the money to not do work, to instead complain. But even more important, what is the impact of this sort of profile on quality, on customer or patient satisfaction, on your ability to recruit and retain great people? And it says you have a significant problem if that's what your organization looks like. This pattern should be exactly reversed. You should be seeing the orange up on the top should be that should be more than 50% of our people are spark plugs. And at the bottom, the purple should be less than 10% of paid hours get wasted. And in some organizations like Southwest Airlines or Zappos or HubSpot, the companies that are consistently recognized as great places to work and that consistently dominate their markets, those patterns are reversed. Now, you could question the methodology. You could say, well, you know, it's not scientifically valid and all, and I'd agree. But I'd say this, if 850 people who work at a company are seeing that, how can you be sure that your customers or your patients aren't seeing the same thing? And a special message for those of you who are leaders, managers, executives, there is a fair amount of research that shows the higher up you get on the organization chart, the rosier become your glasses when you have to answer questions like this. So people at the bottom of the chart may think that your culture sucks, and you say, oh no, our culture is really pretty good. Jim Clifton wrote the book, The Coming Jobs War, and it's really about the fact that we are headed into the mother of all staffing shortages. But Clifton is the head of Gallup, and one of the things they study is employee engagement. And he says a disengaged employee, especially a disengaged manager, is a quality defect. The same way shipping the wrong product to a customer, the same way giving the wrong medication to a patient, the same as, oh, programming a computer with the wrong code, those are defects. If you allow disengaged people to just go through the motions, that's a defect in your organization, he says. A positive workplace culture begins with intolerance for toxic emotional negativity. And the next three or four slides are a special message for managers. You have a responsibility to have the courage to deal with toxic negative attitudes, and it often does take courage, but that is a responsibility that you have. In my book, The Florence Prescription, it says, one toxic negative person can drag down morale and productivity the way one person lighting a cigarette can pollute an entire room, and it is your job as a leader, as a manager, to not tolerate that. And here's a question. When a manager finally drums up the courage to confront that toxic negative person who may have a domineering and intimidating personality, and either discipline or in some cases encourage that person to go work for the competition, what do people say? And without exception, it's what took you so long. A great metaphor, the movie The Wizard of Oz, I know you've seen that. Dorothy throws water on the Wicked Witch. And she's melting. And all the soldiers are looking at Dorothy and saying, you killed her. And Dorothy thinks she's in big trouble, doesn't she? And then what do the soldiers do? They start singing, ding dong, the witch is dead. What took you so long? And you see this over and over in organizations when leadership finally has the courage to say, we're not going to tolerate toxic emotional negativity anymore. Some of the people who you think are part of it, they're just waiting for you to blow the smoke out, the emotional smoke out of the workplace so that they can be more positive and more productive and have a happier work life. So let's talk about practical strategies, practical actions, things you can do to eliminate toxic emotional negativity from your own life, and if enough people take these things to heart, from the place where you work. And as in medicine, it begins with diagnosis. Diagnosis is the first step to cure. So for 1 week, my challenge to you is to pay careful attention and track your own verbal and mental complaining. Carry around a note card in your pocket, and every time you catch yourself mentally complaining about something, and be honest with yourself, just simply pull out your card and make a note. That's all you have to do. We're not asking you to change your thinking or anything. For now, this is a simple diagnostic. This is actually, at a personal level, a variation on the spark plug study I mentioned a few minutes ago, where we have our spark plugs observing toxic emotional negativity in the workplace. Here, instead of looking at other people, you're looking in at yourself. And then at the end of your week, pull out your card deck. I guarantee you it will be more than one card, and count up how many marks are there. Then ask yourself, how long did it last? How long did I get involved with this negative thinking, this complaining, this feeling like a victim? Was it a minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes? Multiply it out. That is how much of your emotional life, your spiritual life, got burned up in the ashtray of toxic emotional negativity over the past week. How many weeks do you want to live? from this point forward. Multiply that out. That's how much your life is going to be toxic, negative, emotionally barren land, because you have given into whining, complaining, thinking, and feeling like a victim. And if that doesn't motivate you to change, I'm not sure what will. It certainly did me, and I've seen it work for thousands of people, and I'm sure it would for millions, but I personally have heard from hundreds of people, and I know in the organizations we worked with, thousands of people I've heard indirectly, simply by paying attention to their own thinking, their own feelings, what's going through their mind, they have been able to start making changes that help them be more positive, productive, and happier. Action number two, wear that purple bracelet. I mentioned Will Bowen's book, A Complaint-Free World, which, by the way, is highly recommended. It's a great book, and he's a guy, I'm sure you've read about him. I think they have something like 10 million of these purple bracelets out there now. And what he says is you put it on one hand. And anytime you catch yourself complaining, and he says it doesn't have to be, if you think something, that doesn't count, but if you say something out loud, you know, I can't believe the flight's late or whatever, oh, there I go. You take the bracelet off your left hand, you put it on your right. And each time it goes back and forth, it's a reminder to you of your own toxic emotional negativity. And what he says is that if you can do that, if you can go 21 days without a single complaint, you will have broken the habit and broken it permanently. And I'm not sure about the math, but I am absolutely convinced that he's right, that if you go for a certain period of time, whether it's 21 days or 66 days, I've read that's what it takes to break a bad habit, it will change your life, and it will change your life in a positive way. He also said that for most people, it takes somewhere between 4 and 8 months to be able to go 21 days without a complaint, which is another indicator of how prevalent it is in our society. Action number three. Earlier I mentioned the book by Mike Crosby, Thank God Ahead of Time. And it is such a powerful and profound attitude to have. You know, anybody who's ever lost a job will eventually say it was the best thing that ever could have happened. In a recent Spark Plug newsletter, I wrote about three people I had heard from all within 1 week who had all lost their jobs, and they were all, I mean, devastated is probably not too strong a word. They were frightened. They were depressed. They were, you know, worried about their own abilities. They went through this whole psychological swirl. And I told all of them, be thankful, because not very long from now, you're going to look back and say, whoa, it's the best thing that ever could happen. And within 3 months, and again, literally in the same week, I heard from all three of them, two of them had just started brand new jobs doing something that was much better, and they're making more money. And the third was trying to decide between the options that he had for a new job. And if your attitude when that bad thing happens can be, oh, thank you, I just lost my job, thank you, I don't know why, but I'll figure it out, you'll figure it out a whole lot more quickly. Now, there's some things where it is, frankly, a whole lot more challenging. You know, if you've been diagnosed with cancer, that is really hard to say thank you. But your ability to fight that cancer, the likelihood of being cured and going into remission from that cancer will be profoundly influenced by the attitude that you go into it with. And if your attitude is, I'm going to find the blessings in here, and there are blessings. I have spent many, many evenings with support groups of people who have cancer or addictions or other horrible things, and the people who seem to do the best are the ones who have been able to find, and if not find, create some meaning in a tragedy that has no inherent meaning. I'll never forget, I was at a meeting once of a group called Compassionate Friends. This is a support group for parents who have lost children, and it's, there's no more horrible tragedy. There's no tragedy that has no inherent meaning like that of losing a child. And yet, as they went around the room and shared their stories, you heard people say things like, you know, I am a much better parent now for my other children because I know how fragile life can be. And somebody else said, you know, I appreciate a butterfly a whole lot more than a pay raise now because I have come to learn what really matters in life. And a woman was writing a book on gun safety because her son had been killed in a hunting accident, and that was going to be her legacy, her her commitment to create meaning in a situation that had no inherent meaning, the death of her son. And, you know, if those people can find something to be thankful for in those kinds of things, what can happen to you or me that we can't say thank you? You know, Harold Kushner wrote that beautiful book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People, and it's true, they do. And they're going to happen to you. You know it. If you wait until it happens to start thinking about how do I create the meaning here, it's going to be a lot harder for you. You know, you lose the job and you go into the victim thing, and eventually, you know, you find out that, sure enough, it was the best thing that could have happened. But if you start programming yourself mentally now to be thankful for whatever happens, no matter what happens, one of the things that will happen is that because you're more positive, because you're more optimistic, you'll behave in different ways, and it will be a whole lot quicker that you do find why it was the best thing that ever could have happened. One last thing. Some of the finest leaders that I've ever met, people who have really changed the world, are people who have taken some horrible tragedy, and whether or not they use the words thank God ahead of time, they have, through their own commitment to not be a victim, to not just whine and complain, but rather to do something about it, have changed our world. The way Candace Leitner, after her daughter was run over and killed by a drunk driver, instead of being a victim, instead of just whining and crying and feeling sorry for herself, she started Mothers Against Drunk Driving. And by one estimate, more than 300,000 people would have been killed by drunk drivers had it not been for the work of Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Action step number 4, be a Pollyanna. You know, when people call me Pollyanna, I say thank you. I cannot think of a higher compliment than being called Pollyanna. And you know, if you read the story or watch the movie, Pollyanna, in the story there is this community that has been fractured and torn apart. There is hate, there is fear, there is contempt. Where there's pain, this incredible, courageous young lady brings healing. Where there's fear, she brings courage. Where people have been alienated from one another, she brings them together. And I say, what's wrong with that? Isn't that what we need today? Probably more than anything. And so I have this strategy that I use, and especially when I get on an airplane, for example. I know sooner or later somebody's going to whine about something, you know, or flight's delayed or whatever. So one of the first things I do after I ask them, you know, are you going home or some icebreaker, I'll say, you know, isn't this amazing? We are about to fly. We are about to do something that the most brilliant man ever in the history of the world, Leonardo da Vinci, spent his entire life fantasizing about doing, and we're about to do it. And you know, it's hysterical because when I do something like that, they never complain, or at least not, they may lean across the aisle and whine to somebody else, but they have written me off as being a non-participant in their little bit session, and so I never hear it. And it's a great way to inoculate myself. It's like putting on a Teflon raincoat that protects me from their toxic emotional negativity. Action step number 5, I will actually do a full webinar on metaphorical visualization, which is a technique we've developed. But it's simply creating a metaphor to help you deal with emotions that are difficult to deal with because they're invisible. And so every time you mentally catch yourself whining or complaining or gossiping about somebody else, imagine pulling a plug. I mean, literally visualize yourself pulling a plug. Or imagine yourself running into a stop sign. Stop. You know, stop thinking this negative thought. Imagine it being up on a blackboard and you erasing it. Now, in a recent spark plug, I wrote about a company that had a six-word culture statement that said, we're tough, we're focused, and we win. And what they had been doing is encouraging their employees to internalize those six words. I'm tough, I'm focused, I win. And I've been trying it myself, and it's amazing. Whenever I start getting negative thinking, negative self-talk, I've been pulling the plug, holding up the stop sign, pulling out the eraser, and erasing whatever it is, and saying, I'm tough, I'm focused, I win. And I'm essentially reprogramming in that area my own thinking. And it's using that metaphor of an eraser to erase what's negative and replace it with what's positive. Now, this is maybe going to be the most difficult one for many of you, and it's also one of the most important. And that is, you might have to change the people you hang around with. The fancy term for that, sociologists call it your reference group. But if you're hanging around with a bunch of toxic, negative, whiny, gossipy people, it's going to be very hard for you to not fall into that trap yourself. In fact, researchers have shown the single best predictor of almost any dimension of your life, how much money you make, your political and religious opinions, your attitude about life, is the income, politics, and attitude of the people that you hang around with. This is why they tell people who are trying to quit drinking, you can't go to the bar. People who are trying to quit smoking, you can't hang around with people who smoke anymore, because we are all much more subject to peer pressure than we think we are. And if you want to change your attitude, start hanging around with people who have a more positive attitude. Now, here's another variation on the metaphor. Anytime you catch yourself complaining, give it what I call the Valley Forge test. Imagine projecting yourself back in time to that horrible winter of 1776-77, when those incredible, courageous patriots who gave us the freedom we enjoy in this country suffered bloody feet in the snow through the horrible winter at Valley Forge. Imagine sitting around the campfire with them as they're trying to stay warm and they haven't eaten in 2 days, and describing your complaint to them. Let's take one from the Louis C.K. video. And then they made us sit there on the runway for 40 minutes. We had to sit there. Imagine saying that to these poor, starving, freezing patriots who gave us the country that we are blessed with today. Now, if they pull out the violins and start feeling sorry for you, by all means, keep complaining, because you definitely have a legitimate complaint. But if they look at you like you just sprouted a third nose, stop whining, stop complaining, and either deal with it or live with it, but stop being a victim. Action number 7, another of the techniques we've developed, the DDQ. Don't get your hopes up, it's not Dairy Queen. The direction deflection question. And it's a very simple question. Is what I'm about to do or say going to help me be the person I want to be, my ideal best self? And here's a variation. Well, what I'm about to say to my coworker, to this customer, this patient, to this family member, reflect me as a positive, cheerful, and optimistic person? And if not, what would I say? And here's a clue. If you don't hear the answer no to that first question a whole lot more than you hear yes, you're probably not being honest with yourself, because psychologists tell us that the human mind pretty much automatically gravitates toward negative, frightening, and depressing thoughts. And you have to consciously reprogram that. And the DDQ is, what I'm about to say going to help me be the person I'm meant to be? And if not, what would I say can help you actually re-script a lot of how you interact with other people to be more positive and constructive. And related to that, something we've been working on more recently is the EDQ, the emotion deflection question. Is the emotion that I'm allowing myself, and note very carefully what I just said, emotions are something that you allow yourself to feel. You can change those emotions. Sometimes it's very hard. Sometimes it's a lot easier than you think it is, especially if it's an emotion that causes gratuitous complaining. But is the emotion I'm allowing myself to feel going to help me be happier and more successful? And if the answer is no, what emotion would I like to be feeling right now? And how can I move myself in the direction? At first, you're going to find both the DDQ and the EDQ very difficult. As you practice it, as you get more into the habit, as you, in effect, wire your brain for making that switch, and it literally almost you'll feel like a switch, it will get easier and easier to flip the switch from negative to positive. Psychologists, scientists have been telling us in the last 20, 30 years about something that is a fairly new field of our understanding called psychoneuroimmunology. It is the relationship between body, mind, spirit, and emotions. And it turns out that your body talks to your mind just every bit as much as your mind talks to your body. You know, Charlie Brown's says, if you're going to be depressed, you got to stand like this. Well, if you stand like that for an hour, I guarantee you're going to be depressed. Your body is engaged in a constant and ongoing dialogue with your mind, telling you what to think and how to feel. Watch this. Just Google Amy Cuddy TED Talk, and it's an 18-minute talk she gave at a TED conference about the power of posture and how simply changing your posture can change how you feel, how you think, and how you project yourself to other people. And in doing that, it can help you change the kind of outcomes you get. So, for example, she says, if you're going in for a job interview, before you go in, you take 2 minutes and you do a power pose. She suggests you do it in the bathroom where nobody can see you. And that will change your emotional state. It will change what you project to the interviewer and make it more likely that you will get the job. And in the same way, pay attention to what your face is saying to other people and what it's saying to yourself. George Patton, General Patton, used to stand in front of a mirror and practice what he called his war face. Now, he didn't do that because he was narcissistic, although he was. He did that for two reasons. One, he knew that he couldn't be sure what his men were seeing if he didn't see it first. He might have thought he was looking fierce and he looked silly, so he had to see. But he also knew at an intuitive level that by changing the look on his face, he changed his own inner spirit. And there's actually since then been a fair amount of research that your mouth tells your mind what to think. And one of the studies, they have people read cartoons and then rate them, whether they're funny or not, but they had to hold the pencil in their mouth. And people who held the pencil with their lips always rated the cartoons as not being funny, and the people holding the pencil with their teeth rated the cartoons as being funny, because when you're holding the pencil with your teeth, it forces you into a grin. Without your being aware of it, simply the structure of your mouth, whether you're smiling or frowning, has a huge impact on how you're feeling. And finally, action step number 10, and the bottom line of this whole webinar, is the Pickle Pledge. It is a simple but not always easy promise that you make to yourself. It will change your life. It has for me, it has for many other people, and if enough people in your organization take it to heart, it will change your organization. We've seen it happen many times. And it's a simple little promise which you can download at our website, or you can get laminated cards from our office. I will turn every complaint, I had to park 6 blocks away and walk all the way to the mall, into a blessing. Thank God you have legs. There are people in wheelchairs who would give anything to have your aching feet. Or a constructive suggestion. You know, maybe if you ate fewer donuts and worked out more, walking 6 blocks wouldn't be such an inconvenience to you. And there's a footnote. It says, by taking this promise, I am pledging to myself that I'm not going to waste my time sitting around complaining, gossiping, and commiserating with other people and allowing them to steal my energy. And again, we call it the Pickle Pledge because people who always complain and whine look like they have a dill pickle stuck in their mouth. I'll tell you how I used it one time and the challenge it can be. I was at an airport. Actually, it was in Cincinnati. And the people right across from me, oh, they were whining and complaining. Oh, we're going to get on one of those little regional jets. I bet they're not going to feed us. The seats are so uncomfortable. It was a 90-minute flight, and they were going on and on. I'm sitting there feeling, actually, I hate to admit it, but it's true. I was feeling very superior about how positive I am. Well, you know, it's just a 90-minute flight. I get on the plane. I'm in the very back next to the window, and the plane is absolutely packed except for the seat next to me. And now I'm thinking, ha, this is the reward I get for having been so positive. And then I look down the aisle, and waddling sideways down the aisle in my direction is coming the largest human being I have ever seen in my life. He made this guy look small, and I am not exaggerating. He got back to the end. He looked at me. He pulled up the seat rest, the armrest between the seats. He apologized, and then he sat on me. Quite literally, he sat on me, and I was squashed sideways next to the window for the next 2 hours. Now, I had a choice to make, didn't I? I could have spent the next 2 hours mentally writing a letter to the CEO of that airline, chastising him, castigating him for having inconvenienced me for 2 hours by making me sit there like that. Or, and I'm sure this guy felt terrible. I know he did. I could have said, hi. What I always say, hi, are you going home or away from home? And he was going away from home. I can't tell you that we had a nice chat for the next 2 hours. We really didn't. He put his headphones on, as did I. But for about 10 minutes, we talked, and I didn't write that letter. Now, it wouldn't have been 2 hours, would it? 2 weeks later, I'd have still been redrafting that letter to the CEO of that airline. And by pulling the plug on it, by saying, what's the blessing here? What's the suggestion here? How do I not become a victim? How do I not fall into the swamp of toxic emotional negativity? I completely changed the experience of those 2 hours, and I did not poison the next 2 weeks with this toxic memory, this rewriting and rewriting of this letter to that CEO. So I'm going to ask you to read that promise again to yourself and then ask yourself these two questions. Number one, if you personally took that promise, I will turn every complaint, my head is killing me, into a blessing. Thank God for modern pharmacology or a constructive suggestion. The first symptom of dehydration is a headache. I should drink some water. Every complaint, you turn it into a blessing and or a suggestion. Would you be happier? Would you be more productive? Would you have better relationships with people, except for the people who can't stand it if you're so positive? And would you personally have greater strength of character? Would you be a happier, stronger, more optimistic, more cheerful person? Question number two, if everybody in your workplace took that promise to heart and really made a good faith effort to stop whining and complaining and to find the blessings and the suggestions, would you do a better job of serving your customers, your patients, of supporting each other? Would it be a better place to work? Would you have higher morale? If you're being honest with yourself, the answer to both of those questions is absolutely yes. And that gets me to what we're going to wrap up on in our last 10 minutes together is the Pickle Challenge. And this is my challenge to you to take that promise and that commitment back to your organization and get everybody there to take the pickle out of their own mouths. And this pickle has taken on a life of its own. I think partly because it's such a graphic metaphor. We can all visualize somebody sucking on a vinegar-soaked pickle, and we've all been that person. But I also think it's because we all recognize just how prevalent it is, how toxic it is, and how nice our lives and our work could be if we could blow that toxic emotional negativity out of the workplace. And we are seeing people do amazing things. They're bringing in pickle jars and fining each other. Every time you bitch, moan, whine, complain, gossip, you put a quarter in the jar. And as you see the quarters piling up, it is a visual reflection of how negative people are. And we're seeing people do pickle jar decorating contests. We're seeing people put up signs saying, leave your pickles at the door. I don't want to hear it. This is a pickle-free zone, the way we used to declare our workspace, a smoke-free zone. I don't want to hear your complaining, your criticizing, your gossiping. Take it to the employee health program psychiatrist. They get paid to hear it. We're seeing people do singing pickles and dancing pickles as a way of lightening up the spirit in their workplace. We're seeing people put up bulletin boards and asking their coworkers to sign the pledge as a commitment that they're not going to whine and complain, that they're going to deal with their problems or live with them, but they're not going to whine about them. I saw Mr. Pickle here. This guy is a 4-foot pinata. I found him at White River Health System in Arkansas. And he travels around the whole health system, and when you get him, you get to dress him up in any way you want as a reminder to leave your pickles at the door. I was so impressed, I commissioned the artist to make Mr. Pickle Jr., and he is now in the values coach office. We are seeing people gather together in groups every single day and reminding each other. And this only takes about 2 minutes. But as a group, reminding each other, I am not going to bitch, moan, whine, complain, or gossip. I'm going to deal with my problems or live with them. But I am not going to be a victim. And I am not going to suck the energy out of other people with my own whining and complaining. We're seeing hula pickles as this one at a hospital in Nebraska. And this is one of the most amazing things. At the Battle Creek VA Medical Center, they had a pickle party. And that's permanent marker. They put that up on the wall in permanent marker and had a pickle party. They brought in a pickle cake and pickle jars. And when I was talking to the person who organized this, she said they're sharing it with veterans. And one of the things they're finding is one of the first steps to getting veterans to get over some of the bigger problems they have, like PTSD, is simply to stop feeling like a victim. And that simple promise, I will turn every complaint into either a blessing or a constructive suggestion, is helping the veterans let go of the things that are causing them to have such stress, to have such depression, to have such anxiety. The first step is often not thinking like a victim. And the person who told me this, a social worker there, said some of the words that she has heard are things like transforming, life-changing, and miracle. And when I was there, I had the privilege of meeting with a group of veterans who have been using the 12 core action values, using the Pickle Pledge, and that was the word they used, miracle. And it is when you can stop giving in to toxic emotional negativity, when you can stop whining and complaining and instead deal with your problems like a grown-up, that can be a miraculous transformation. We're hearing things like this from the CEOs of hospitals that are using it. Shannon Sorensen at Brown County Hospital in Nebraska said, it's helping us create a culture where toxic emotional negativity is simply unacceptable. And in the last week, I've spoken with two other CEOs who are involved in the Values Collaborative, both of whom told me that their most toxic, most negative people have voluntarily left the organization because they simply can't stand the fact that nobody listens to them, nobody commiserates with them, that people are so unremittingly positive and cheerful and optimistic, and they felt marginalized, and they were marginalized by the fact that they're not being the center of attention anymore. One of the things that Will Brown in the Complaint Free World book said, we complain for is to be the center of attention, that they on their own leave. And what's happening is the positive culture is ejecting them the way a healthy body will eject a mismatched organ donation. One of the best ways for you to be a more positive person, to have a more positive future about yourself, a more positive work life, is simply to internalize this simple promise. Get the pickle out of your mouth. Stop whining about your problems and either deal with them or live with them. When you are able to do that, if you can eradicate toxic emotional negativity in your life, in your workplace, everybody wins. Your organization will be much more positive, much more productive. In the companion report to this webinar on a positive approach to negative people, I contrasted Southwest Airlines versus United Airlines, Costco versus Walmart, and a number of other companies where the major difference between one being successful and profitable and the other always struggling is the attitude of the people who work there. The individual wins. You win. Because when you stop complaining and whining, when you break that habit, and it is a habit, you're going to be happier. People are going to like you more. They're going to want to be around you because people like to be around positive people, and they don't like to be around negative pickle suckers, except for other negative pickle suckers. And as Martin Seligman promised, you're going to be more successful at achieving your most important goals. And your family wins, because instead of coming home at the end of the day with all of your problems, all of your negativity, work sucks, and then you die, you're going to come home as a more positive person. You're going to be an energy faucet instead of an energy drain. Everybody wins. And you'll win, too. So I really do. I hope that you will take to heart this simple promise, turn every complaint into a blessing or a constructive suggestion. I hope you will share the Pickle Pledge with people where you work. Do it. Make it fun. You know, don't hammer people. Don't say, oh, you got to do this. Make it fun. Ask, you know, a lot of those ideas that I showed you on the previous slides, I didn't come up with the hula pickle, the dancing pickle, the pickle bulletin board. These are ideas that people on their own came up with. So ask your people, you know, here's a promise that can be life-changing. How do we want, what can we do? What can we do that's fun? What can we do that will help us be more aware of our own negativity so that we can be happier, more positive, more productive people? If you do that, I hope that I will be hearing from you, as I have heard from many people and said myself, that it really is. It is a miraculous change when you can become more aware of your own inner negativity, when you can erase that negative self-talk, when you can prevent it from being projected outward in the form of complaining, and you can replace it with positive thinking, positive self-talk, and you can replace it with being nice and civil and kind to other people instead of always whining and complaining about what a victim you are. Again, I'm Joe Tai. I thank you for joining me. Send me an email, joe@joetai.com, if you have any questions at all about what I've covered in the webinar. If you'd like me to send you additional information, I'd be happy to do it. Again, thanks for joining me. I will hopefully see you on the next webinar.